Welcome to the first lecture of Physics 155, Mathematical and Computational Physics. This is entitled Lecture Zero, Devious Math Tricks, What Your Math Teacher Never Told You. It's Lecture Zero because it really isn't introducing any new content. It's showing you some devious math tricks that I hope you've seen in your career before this class, but if you haven't, I hope that this lecture will be very eye-opening for you. The first thing I want to point out is the myth of the math genius. There's no such thing as a born math genius. Excelling at math simply takes training and skill. This lecture is going to give you some of the tools that you need to become an expert, and I'm emphasizing these tools because perhaps you've never seen them before, and that's really a shame, and I want to make sure that you have seen them. It'll help you become adept at doing math quickly as well. The five devious tricks are going to really change the way that you do math forever. So what's our first one? Our first one is the add zero trick. What could be easier than x plus 0 equals x? Let me show you how you use the trick. It solves many, many different problems, and the challenge is picking out what you're going to use as a zero to add. So let's look at an example, factor x squared minus 25. Now, I know many of you probably have memorized that when you have the difference of two squares, you easily know how to do the factorization. But let's actually work out what it was if we did not know that and we hadn't memorized it. In order to do the factorization, I'm going to need some terms that are linear in x as well. And looking at the two terms, it seems like adding and subtracting 5x, which is adding 0. You see the numbers in red there, they add up to 0. That is likely to help and do the trick. So what we're going to do now is we're going to regroup those terms into x times x minus 5 plus 5 times x minus 5. And then you see I can easily do a factorization of that into x plus 5 times x minus 5. And all we did was add 0. Now you might say, look, that's really a lot of work. I already knew what the factorization is. The key is that the add 0 trick allows you to derive many, many new identities that you didn't know simply by recognizing that adding the right 0 allows you to solve the problem when it looked intractable before you figured out that you could add 0 to it. Okay, devious math trick number 2, very similar. We multiply by 1. Simply says x times 1 is equal to x. This is something that I'm sure you have seen before. It's very similar to the add 0 trick, the multiply by 1 trick. It also helps us convert many expressions into more familiar forms. It often is taught in the form of doing either something like rationalizing the denominator if you have square roots in a denominator. Here, I want to multiply this by 1 and get rid of the square roots in the denominator. The multiply by 1 is, of course, going to be 1 minus 2 square root of 3 divided by 1 minus 2 square root of 3. Now, you'll see in a moment why that is going to rationalize the denominator, but knowing that when I take a product of the sums times the product of the differences, I get the difference of the squares, lets you know that this has got to get rid of the quadratic term in the denominator. We now just go through the multiplication. You can see that if I take the numerator, I'll have 1 times 1, I'll have 1 times minus 2 root 3, I'll have minus root 3 times 1, and then I'll have minus root 3 times minus 2 root 3. And then in the denominator, I'll have the difference of the squares, 1 minus the square of 2 root 3. So we can put those together. We're going to get 1 minus 3 root 3 plus 6 divided by 1 minus 6. We then can simplify that. We get minus 7 fifths plus 3 fifths root 3. And this is also very useful in working with rationalizing the denominator of complex numbers. If you've not seen that before, you will later in the class. We can use it in other ways as well. Let's look at a product of integers, n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 3, all the way out to 2n. That gets cumbersome to write down in an abstract way. But if I just multiply by 1, and in this case I'm going to choose 1 to be 1 times 2 times 3 all the way out to n, divided by 1 times 2 times 3 all the way out to the n. If I regroup now that numerator, you can see I've got two factorials. I've got a factorial in the numerator because it's the product of all integers from 1 to 2n, and a factorial in the denominator. So just by using the definition of the factorial, we can write that much more compactly as 2n factorial divided by n factorial. All right, devious trick number three. Remember the simple identities. I'm going to give you 10 simple identities to remember at the end of this lecture and use them to make more complicated identities. Again, this is not an exact science, but it is something that you really can get used to doing with practice once your eyes have been opened to point out looking at it. So what I'm going to show you is that most trig identities can be derived simply by remembering the definitions of the trig functions and using the fact that cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to 1. So let's give an example. Let's express secant squared in terms of tangent. How do I do that? Well, first, let me start from the definition of secant squared. Secant is 1 over cosine, so secant squared is 1 over cosine squared. You can see there's a 1 in the numerator there. I want to now use my trig identity and substitute that 1 by cosine squared theta plus sine squared theta. So let's go ahead and do that in the numerator. And now you can recognize that the first term is just equal to 1, and the second term is just equal to sine theta over cosine theta quantity squared. And if you remember your definitions of trig functions, that's just tan theta squared. So there you go. You derive that identity. And this works for essentially all of those identities that you thought you had to memorize and then gave up because it was impossible to remember all of them. Now you know that you don't actually need to. Just by using cosine squared theta plus sine squared theta and remembering the trig definitions can get you very far and get you through most of those identities. And it doesn't work just for trig functions. It works for a whole bunch of other functions as well, a whole bunch of other complicated identities. Really valuable thing to keep in mind when you're trying to work on doing algebra. Devious trick number four, recognize simple identities when they're expressed in a complex form. This is a really important thing. Sometimes there's a simple identity sitting right in front of you, but you can't recognize it because the form is too complicated and you're having trouble making that abstraction to recognize the simple identity. So let's see how to use the identity that we worked out earlier, x squared minus 25 is x plus 5 times x minus 5. We're going to use it to simplify sine squared theta minus 25 divided by cosine squared theta. So we can recognize there that if x is equal to sine theta, I can immediately write that as sine theta plus 5 times sine theta minus 5 divided by cosine squared theta. Now let me distribute that cosine squared theta as a denominator for each of those factors. You can see I'll get a sine theta over cosine theta, and I'll get a 5 over cosine theta. And just using those trig definitions, I can rewrite that as tangent theta plus 5 secant theta times tangent theta minus 5 secant theta. And there you go. We found an interesting identity just by recognizing that we already had that identity. It was just written in a more complex form. Now, a harder example would be to factorize x to the fourth plus 2x squared minus 24. Now, this is going to require us to use a couple of different tricks and put them together. The first one we're going to put in is our add zero. X to the fourth plus 2x squared is almost a perfect square. If I add 1 to it, it is a perfect square. So I'm going to add 1 and subtract 1 using our add zero trick. I'll then recognize that that first term is x squared plus 1 squared. And now I'm going to take that leftover minus 1 and add it to the minus 25. And now I'm going to recognize that I'm going to have those two terms in the form of this x squared minus 25 identity. It's just now the x is equal to x squared plus 1 in this case. So I'm going to rewrite that as using that identity as x squared plus 1 plus 5 and x squared plus 1 minus 5. When we combine those together, we'll get x squared plus 6 times x squared minus 4. Now, some people feel more comfortable letting x squared go to y first and then letting y go to x squared at the end. If you fall in that camp, please go ahead and do that. It's a perfectly fine thing to do. You might even think that it's better to let x squared plus 1 go to y first and then let y go to x squared plus 1 afterwards as well. That's also an okay way to work through this. All right, devious trick number 5. This is our last devious trick. Use what you know and only what you know. I can't tell you how many times just doing this will get you much farther along. Let me ask you, how many times have you been given a problem set? You open it up, you start looking at the first problem, and you're like, I have no idea how to do this. And then often, the next thing you do is you start searching the web. I'm going to try to get you to stop searching the web and instead look for what you know and try to see how you can get from what you know to where you need to be. And yes, it does require you to think, but you'll find that it really makes you an independent problem solver if you can do this. Let's look at an example based on the geometric series. What if I had to do this summation, x squared plus x to the fourth plus x to the sixth, which can be written in the standard summation form as the sum n equals 1 to infinity, x raised to the 2nth power. This looks a lot like the geometric series. Let's let x squared go to y, and then the summation becomes the sum n equals 1 to infinity of y to the n. If it was a sum n equals 0 to infinity of y to the n, it would be the geometric series. So this is telling us let's use our add 0. Let's add in the term that corresponds to n equals 0 and then subtract it. And now let's combine those first two terms, y to the n plus 1, into a single summation, making that index go from 0 to infinity. Now that summation is the geometric series if the modulus of y is less than 1, in which case I can replace it by 1 over 1 minus y, and now I can simplify this. And when I simplify it, well, first I'm going to substitute in y goes to x squared, and then I'm going to simplify this, and you see I'm going to get x squared over 1 minus x squared. And there you have it. We've done that summation. Even though this is a summation that you can't easily look up somewhere and have someone tell you what it is. So whenever you are stuck on a problem, ask yourself, what do I know? I even find it's useful for you to write down what do you know. And how can I get from what I know to where I need to be? I don't know whether many of you have seen the Douglas Adams series called Dirk Gently, Holistic Detective. As I'm going to show you in a quote from him, usually the answer is then going to be staring right in front of you for you to see. So Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency is an interesting series of books by Douglas Adams. He's the same person who wrote Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And in the second volume of that, called Tea Time for the Soul, he has a quote, "I may not have gone where I intended to go, but I think I have ended up where I needed to be." That's from The Long, Dark Tea Time of the Soul. The quote comes from a interesting story where the detective has gotten a lead. He's trying to find a woman, and he just gets in his car and starts driving. He has an address for the woman, but he doesn't even look at a map. He just starts driving. And he knows that he doesn't always get to exactly where he intended to go, but he always ends up where he needs to be. Turns out along the way to trying to drive to this woman's house, he gets into a car accident. And lo and behold, the woman driving the car is the woman he was trying to meet. And that's how you get into, that's where this quote originated. This is not something that is getting into a psychic reality or anything like that. It simply is telling you that once you gather what you know and you try to put that together into where you need to go, you often find you have all the tools to allow you to get there. All right, here's now another useful skill. It's not really a trick, but it's a skill that I find students often have trouble with. That previous problem could be solved by something that we like to call index shifting. And I know that students are often frightened by this. It is essentially the skill where you take a power series and you shift the index in the power series. But it really is a fairly easy skill to master. So let's go back to our original problem that we were just looking at with devious trick number 5, summing x squared plus x to the fourth plus x to the sixth and so forth. It's a sum n equals 0 to infinity of x to the 2n. Again, it would be the geometric series if I could make that sum go from n equals 0 to infinity. So let's just go ahead and do that. Let's start it from n equals 0. That means I have to let the n, the dummy index in my summation, go to n plus 1. So that's what the index shifting is. We're going to let n go to n plus 1. That means I have a sum n equals 0 to infinity of x to the 2 times n plus 1. You can see that that's covering exactly the same set of terms when you substitute in n equals 0, n equals 1, and so forth. It'll go through exactly all of those terms on the left-hand side. But now what I can do is I can factor out, and I can pull out that x squared, and then I can recognize the term in red is now the geometric series. I can re-express it as the geometric series, and there I'm done. I've got the same answer as we've gotten before, but it's in many respects an easier way of getting there. All right, I promised you 10 identities that you need to master to do anything else. This is my big top 10 list. The first one is the quadratic equation. Ax squared plus bx plus c has two roots. R plus minus equals minus b over 2c plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2c, a really important identity that you should memorize and remember. The fundamental trigonometric identity, we already encountered this. This is cosine squared plus sine squared equals 1. Remembering what the trigonometric definitions are, this is secant theta is 1 over cosine theta, tan theta is sine theta over cosine theta, cosecant theta is 1 over sine theta, and cotangent theta is cosine theta divided by sine theta. Those are the four identities or trig definitions you need to remember. The double angle formulas, cosine 2 theta is cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta, and sine 2 theta is 2 sine theta cosine theta. From this, you can get half angle formulas just by going from the right to the left rather than the left to the right. You also can substitute in for cosine squared or sine squared using the fundamental trigonometric identity, and that will give you a different form for the cosine 2 theta identity. And finally, if you want to really be an expert, you can extend this instead of just being the double angle formula to the angle summation formula for cosine theta plus theta prime and sine theta plus theta prime. I find that in general, when I need that, if I can't remember it, it's okay to go look that up. That doesn't come up as often as the double and half angle formulas, which you get from remembering this. The next one is remembering the factorization of the difference of squares. X squared minus a squared is x plus a times x minus a. We now know that we can derive that by doing add zero, but it's much easier and quicker to remember this. This does come up so often, it's just useful to remember it. Another important trick, if it was x squared plus a squared, I could do the same thing, but now my a is I times a, where I is the imaginary number, the square root of minus one. Then there are three series I want you to remember. The geometric series, sum n equals 0 to infinity, x to the n is equal to 1 over 1 minus x for mod x less than 1. I also think it's very important for you to remember the partial sum that is used to derive the geometric series, and we're going to do that later in the course, but I'm putting it up here in case you have seen it before. It's that when you have that finite sum, sum n equals 0 to big N of x to the n, I can write that as 1 minus x to the n plus 1 divided by 1 minus x, and that actually holds for all x. It doesn't need the absolute value of x to be less than 1. There's the binomial theorem. X plus y raised to the nth power is the sum n equals 0 to n, big N, big N choose little n, x to the big N minus n, y to the n. This sometimes appears when x or y is equal to 1, which makes the whole series quite a bit easier. And then I'm showing you what the binomial coefficient is. It's big N factorial divided by little n factorial times big N minus little n factorial in the denominator. All right, the next series that you really need to remember is the power series for the exponential. E to the x is the sum n equals 0 to infinity, 1 over n factorial x to the n. And then there are two more that I think are really important to remember. You can derive these from the power series, but it's useful to remember these. The relation of the trig functions to exponentials, that cosine theta is 1 half e to the I theta plus e to the minus I theta, and sine theta is 1 over 2i e to the I theta minus e to the minus I theta. And finally, the same thing for the hyperbolic trig functions. It's useful to remember these as well. Hyperbolic cosine is 1 half e to the x plus e to the minus x, and hyperbolic sine is 1 half e to the x minus e to the minus x. And that's it. Remembering these 10 identities and using those five devious math tricks, and really the most important ones are the first two, the add zero and multiply by one, that is going to take you to the next level in your algebra. And I hope you will be able to use these tricks in the work that you're going to be doing in this class, and you'll have plenty of opportunity to practice and develop them further as we go through the semester.